All right, so the last thing we're going to talk about today is Tripp and I got to play a very special game that's very close to our hearts. And that is Final Fantasy VII Remake.
The Final Fantasy VII Remake demo snuck so into existence.
I was watching Neo play it.
The NDA. Yeah, you did. I was actually recording this video I'm about to pull up in just a second. But we got to play it on Monday when the NDA dropped because a lot of the press got to play a 3 or 4 hour chunk of it. And they've actually been talking about that a lot. Oh, look at that. Pops right up. I love it. Don't want to hear my voice because I didn't audio balance well. All right. So Tripp, what did you think of it? I haven't really heard your thoughts yet.
Yeah. We've talked a little bit in the Discord about it. And I also streamed the game that day. What was it? Monday. Yesterday. Yeah, yesterday morning. I started my stream playing through this. I almost didn't. I was like, It's chapter one of the game. So
you've
this,
been very like, I don't want to watch the intro that they dropped.
I definitely don't want to watch the intro.
I just want to play the game when
it
comes out.
Which it's part of this. So, you know, but I wanted to wait until like I saw it wrapped up in the whole package. And I almost didn't play this for the same reasons. But then I'm like, I can't not. I have to know what this game is going to be like. I have to get a little bit of a tease because this is literally the first game that I like truly deeply fell in love with when I was a kid. Final Fantasy VII. I know I'm not the only one that has that experience.
I'm
a lot of people.
Yeah, literally right there
like,
with you.
Yeah, exactly.
My first PS1 demo game.
And I didn't even have a PS1. I found this at Best Buy for the PC. So I was so excited to be able to like participate in this world and learn about Final Fantasy that I had heard so much about. And like, you know, EGM and all these magazines I was reading that looked so cool. So I was like, all right, I'm going to do it. I'm going to play it. And it brought back so much nostalgia and so many chills I got watching this game and playing this in its full remade glory. I think one of the things that they hit the nail on the head with is the same feeling of wonder that you had in the original, just in a fully up-res version of the game. Like this specific shot we're watching Neo stream right here is like the first iconic shot where Cloud hops off of the train. And all these are pre-rendered backgrounds with pixel characters in the original. So you're running around on blocky, kind of chibi almost animated style.
Static art backgrounds.
So they're pre-rendered and static, and you run around on the characters. And like you see these moments, but you don't get to run around in them in 3D. Mm-hmm. And they keep the iconic camera angles of when you see these panels. But then, of course,
they switch back
into
a
full
3D
world. So you can run around and fully explore and really get like the vibe and the feeling of the world. And so that's kind of the theme that I'm picking up from what they're doing with the remake. They're keeping your core experiences and they're inflating them. They're adding to them. They're growing them in ways that maybe you imagined when you were playing this as a kid when it first came out.
Well, back then your imagination filled in a lot of the gaps that the art kind of couldn't do that for you. Yeah.
So they're making that vibe happen. And they're bringing you back that feeling of wonder and exploration.
Turn-based at the time or action RPG?
Yes. The game is a Japanese RPG. And what that meant, especially very hardline back in those days, is you just had like a very simple, not simple in terms of mechanics, but like the party system was your team and the enemy's team and everything was turn-based. You put your commands in. The enemies had their turns with their hidden, you know, stats and everything. And then you kind of just turn-based until it was done. This game is taking a much more modern spin on things. It's a very active game. It's all kind of live positioning yourself around the enemies. You have an attack button. But they're trying to mix a little bit of that turn-based combat in that you remember. You can actually hit your X button while you're playing and bring up a menu that stops time. It's moving incredibly slowly, so it's like dynamic looking, but it's essentially you stop time and can take your time to input your commands. So if you know, you want to see someone use a skill or a spell, but you're not sure if you know who you're going to attack or where you're going into your menus for, it actually does slow everything down and keep it kind of, you know, frozen so you don't mess up. Because a lot of these things are a lot more challenging than they were in the original game. Like this section of the game where you start is very tutorial focused, and the same applies here. Mm-hmm. But in the original game, it didn't matter what you did. You just either attack or use your magic. You were just getting through this bombing
mission, they throw you head first into this mission.
Even the boss you fight at the end of the sequence in the original wasn't challenging. You could just attack the whole time.
I remember like 10-year-old me being like, this is really hard. I don't know what I'm doing.
They teach you a little bit by saying in the game, don't attack when its tail is up.
That's right.
Even if you attack when its tail is up, you don't get a game over. You get hurt a lot, but you can recover.
You take more damage,
I died during this boss, dude, trying to juggle all
the
mechanics.
Really?
I did.
I did not.
Yeah.
I'm gonna fast forward to him right here. When you run in, this is the iconic Scorpion tank from the end of the bombing run here. And a lot does happen in this game. He jumps on the walls. Because in the original game, you're standing literally just standing across from the boss.
The boss is nothing different than the
characters are just lined up in a row across from them, right?
Mm-hmm.
So now, I already skipped it. I went too far.
F.
No, yeah. So like things happen in this fight where like debris falls down, and then like your characters go
like to avoid the iconic tail laser, you have to position yourself behind
and
the
as you can see,
or you will literally die.
Wow. See, here's the time stop when I'm in menus. Oh. Yeah.
I'm not even a Final Fantasy player, and like the more like I stopped by their booth and I watched this, and like I'm definitely playing it.
This is probably going to be the easiest. Like I know 15 said that like this is the game to get into.
Yeah, they say every game.
Well, 15, there was like a message when you started 15 that was like, this is for new and old returning Final Fantasy players. Like there was like a whole thing about it.
Yep.
Yeah. I could play this.
Could you really and like browse menus while for your attacks and stuff and switch characters in mid fight?
Yeah, I could play it.
Because it's cool, because you can dynamically like switch the character you play as. So, for example,
like
GTA. but at the same time,
you know what I mean?
Sure.
Like campaign mode.
So there are moments when the Scorpion, and I'm just trying to find it, where he'll like jump on the walls, and Cloud can't reach him because he uses a giant sword.
Right,
exactly.
So that's all Barret.
But you switch to Barret, so then you can focus on bringing his attacks in.
Because Barret's got a gun on him.
See, now here I switch to Barret because now Cloud can't move in, so I'm going to be using Barret to put fire down on him, right? Mm-hmm. So you gotta make those kind of decisions, and I like that tactical nature of that they're trying to like kind of like fish hook into the game a little bit.
To be honest with you, I played a lot of games, and I've definitely played games where I dynamically shift between two characters.
Oh, cool! Yeah, for sure.
And then the other one will just do something else.
So that's
like
why I brought up 15.
Like Red Dead and those Rockstar games.
Oh, for sure. That's why I brought up 15 because this game, I think, is more so like this is one of the most popular Final Fantasies ever.
Mm-hmm.
It was so popular they made movies and they made continuing games of it for the longest time. This is going to be a remake of a classic, which it looks like they're bringing this interpretation of it to the modern age, a la Resident Evil 2 in a way.
Yeah,
the accessibility looks a lot easier. It's not slow and boring. It's flashy and beautiful.
Right,
like they're adding a lot to the story, and frankly, experiencing the story in a new light is probably what I'm most excited about.
Yeah, as you're running through this reactor, they had so many moments to expand on character interaction, add new dialogue, give you more motivation, and they took all of those opportunities, and it was so well done. Like, not only did we get expansions on relationships between characters, like there was always a little bit of an undertone or overtone, really, that
Jesse
kind of like thought Cloud was cute, but in this game, she's like overtly flirting with him all the time. And it's like, we all knew that it was happening, but like to hear it being put so plainly and have everyone else react to it. Like the one conversation that her and, who was it? Was it Wedge? It was Wedge, right? When they were setting the one bomb up in the beginning, Neo, it was like, she was mentioning how Cloud was cute. And like, if you stand and just listen to them, they have a whole conversation. And he turns into like, well, I guess that means I'm not anything. She's like, don't take it there. Like it was such a real in-depth kind of like fun, like bantery conversation. And obviously you couldn't
just
ever get
little,
that. It was actually this moment, I think, right around here.
Nailed it.
The lore is more detailed.
It really is, and they've captured the vibe of the characters. I've heard some feedback that some people don't like what they've done with Barret, and I don't think they really did anything different with him though.
No,
which could be a good or a bad choice, but he's pretty much the same as he was.
He was a highly exaggerated character.
Very
1997 game. I think he's
like
a lot
Arnold Schwarzenegger type,
like a Mr. T.
He was literally like
John
a Mr. T like
now It's literally, and please take this with a grain of salt, but and remember it was a different time back then too, but since there isn't a big like black presence in Japan, he's a lot of like black people's idea of what, or Japanese people's idea of what black people would be like.
A stereotype.
Yeah, very stereotypical when they wrote that character.
So I think they are, from what I've seen so far, he's still an exaggerated character in a way because of the way his character is, but I feel like they're really fixing a lot of like that in the dialogue.
No one would have thought that it was problematic at the time, but like they are keeping like the character's aggressions and motivations, but also like making it like, okay, I can understand someone having that kind of a conversation.
Yeah, you're in a elevator with him later, and he's like ranting about like the Mako. And first off, didn't know it was pronounced Mako.
Oh yeah,
said Mako since 1997. Just saying.
I said Mako, but I knew it was Mako.
It's okay.
I also
said Tifa for the longest time.
Oh, see, I said Tifa.
Yeah, and that's the thing. Like now, I'm like listening to these characters say their own voice, their own names. Mm-hmm. Never knew this because they never spoke their names.
You know, it gets a lot of people upset that I like It's I know I'm wrong, and I know it's a hill that I'm just dying on myself, but I say Ares.
You say Ares?
Yeah.
Ares?
Yeah. I know. Like see? Look at his face right now.
What's the character's name?
It's
Eris, but Aerith, because Japanese don't have that sound. Mm.
But the in Japan, the name is Erisu, and that su at the end could be mm-hmm. So it's rarely no hard answer one way or the other, but people in America have for years landed on Aerith as like the English
the translation
like is, spelling of the name. I just say, no, fuck that. It sounds weird. I'm like saying it. It sounds very lispy. I'm not a fan.
Yeah. So another thing about the combat, we had a lot of conversation about the combat this morning
because
we were like, we were pretty talky about it.
Mm-hmm.
Do you like the numbers?
I love damage numbers.
Yeah, it's fucking.
I added
them
in Fallout.
I want to see bigger numbers, and that's what what you have the numbers, dude, because you want to see those numbers get bigger.
Mm-hmm.
I added them in Fallout.
So one thing I do, I
great.
Love the numbers.
I know we were kind of complaining about the combat this morning, but I think the combat actually can evolve and grow in a really good way. I see it going in a really cool direction.
Yeah, and I think a lot of the things that I had problems with will be fixed when your character has more ability. Like, I think they funnel you into tough situations to have you naturally find the walls of the gameplay and get around those and learn how to play better.
I have to adapt to having a block and dodge button in a Final Fantasy game, and that's not something I really have
I
to
also
do.
Literally forgot until right now rewatching the footage, because one of the things I complained about was when you swap characters, the camera doesn't auto-adjust. But I realized that I didn't make use of the mechanic at all where you click in the right stick and lock onto the enemy. If I was locking onto the boss, I'm sure
and,
if I swapped,
another thing
it would
have
been so much smoother.
When playing Barret, if you fire like his big charge blast off, then if he finishes in the middle of that attack, if he finishes, he'll just target the next weakest thing.
Yeah.
And so he'll just continue. There's no break in his attack.
Yeah.
Cloud has a really cool move where he changes his stance to a Punisher mode. It slows him down. You can't block, but all your moves are like they hit harder. And, and he's a stronger character. So I found myself...
Cloud's the sword guy.
He's the sword guy.
He is the what we'd call the protagonist of the story. Yeah. He's the main guy.
He's the main dude.
The one thing that I do think could be better is the character you're not actively controlling. I think they need to do more in terms of like attacking the enemy, because attacking, just literally holding the square button to do a basic attack, is how you build your ATB gauge, and your ATB gauge is how you do anything. It's how you
I'm blocking it. My video's blocking
it's how you use a spell. It's even how you use an item. You can't use an item unless you have at least one bar of your ATB gauge filled up. And I, a lot of times, had to swap over to Barret to have him, like, shoot with his gun to fill up the ATB gauge to then heal Cloud while I had Cloud do, like, the positional attack or something. So I just wish that maybe that other AI-controlled character in the AI moments was more, like, active about attacking to keep your gauge full to give you the ability to act.
Yeah, that's down here at the bottom right here.
I got a good question.
Yeah.
I think you guys said that this game's development is based on the engine used for 15.
Most likely.
Yeah, there's a lot of similarities. I don't know, like, specifically if they imported it and then changed it or built on it.
How's the gameplay compared? Like, how the mechanics work?
Well, you're not in 15, you like teleport around, but if it uses, it's probably just using the same graphics engine completely, and they've just made a new combat system that will.
So it's a different combat system.
I think
but there are things. All Final Fantasies have different combat systems.
Okay.
Yeah. There's design similarities for sure, but I think that's more of like because there were similar directors between not only this but also like Kingdom Hearts and things like that, where you are playing a more action-oriented type of RPG. But I think the system itself is new based on the fact that not only can you play this actively, but you can also go in your menus and have this whole, you know, menu system as well.
Cool.
But I loved being in this world, and I love seeing it in 3D, and I'm very, very excited. Like, my opinions about what could be better are just, they're nitpicky, and like, we're on a podcast. Like, let's talk about, let's get into
the
weeds
game,
with it.
When
you know?
The game comes like, out, it's only going to be a segment from the overall story.
So this, I mean, the percentages are a hard conversation, but when you're in this city, the city of Midgar, where you start, you don't know that there's a whole big wide world outside of this when you start the game, you know, especially for the first time. That's a very cool moment, and you learn the world is so much wider than this, and this is probably maybe 10 to 20% of the full game.
That's going to come.
Yeah.
10 to 15 even. Like, not even. 20 is a lot.
I think
when you say that, are you referring to the full game that may eventually come out?
No, like, the original. Like, if we're putting this in the timeline of the original.
Yeah, this is
when you get out
of
Midgar,
the full game.
You have, you
when
are
you
just
say
beginning
this,
of the
are
game.
You referring to the demo or are you referring to the game that will be released?
Listen to what I'm saying.
Sorry.
When you get to the end of what this game will be, the remake.
This game.
This game.
That
remake.
Is not out
this
yet.
Game. you will get to what was essentially the end of like the beginning of the original release game.
Cool. Correct.
So it's going to be interesting to see where they take it, because this is a much more story focused way of experiencing the game, where once this section ended, you were in an open world. Literally an overworld.
The game expands even more.
And then you are a little character running on like a planet.
So the game could become very open world, like in the traditional, the sense we know open world to be now.
We just don't know. I don't know.
Wasn't 15
gonna...
like that? That was open world.
No.
That started open world. And it was just a large open map.
Right. It's more like this game, and they don't have to do this, but it was a limitation thing. You left your city, and then we're on a big open world with tinier cities that represented the city you were just in.
Yeah.
Then you literally ran your character model into it, and you were in the city, the town.
Like Mario World.
Right.
Kind of, yeah.
Yeah, kind of.
I think one thing that's bothering me right now about the marketing of this game is that they haven't even come clean publicly about that this is part one of a multi-part game that they're making.
Yeah, it's a strange choice to not put part one on there.
Or something
and
like that.
And I don't want to like infer
what their
deviousness, you know?
But doesn't it make it a little devious that they haven't said that when we're like less than a month out?
That they haven't said. I mean, they've said it's multi-part, but you're worried that it's not printed on the package.
Correct.
Yeah you need the confirmation. Yeah.
It's going to give, oh, this is Final Fantasy's remake. This is the remake of this game.
Right.
That is your. It's literally on the box what you would expect, right? Like that's like, kind of like misleading by omission of telling us the full truth.
No,
right?
if I were someone that somehow
teasing you.
Wasn't on the internet at all, if I had no context about this, I would assume I'm getting the entire experience.
We're outliers because where we live this shit.
And I would agree with
it's,
that. Yeah,
it's essentially designed as a service game. So it's essentially they're going to release these as like DLC packages.
I wouldn't use the label service game, because when you think of service game, you think of Division, Destiny,
online,
stuff like that.
Always persistent. Yeah. Anyway,
but they are going to be releasing this in chunks, and we don't know how many breaks it's going to be, how many single $60 releases it's going to be. It's just all speculation. All we know is they are working on the second. That's all they've said.
They said that.
Correct me if I'm wrong. Are they doing a mobile thing?
They do a lot of mobile things.
Shadowverse. Is that Final Fantasy? Is that under that umbrella? Because they were demoing some game like Shadowverse. I don't know. I swore I saw like Final Fantasy Mobile while I was at PAX. And I know I'm not making this up.
Well, this does not look like Final Fantasy
Mobile. Okay, so then I think I'm making something up.
Looks like a game, though.
Okay, so then let's go back, because hashtag not sponsored.
Fate Stay Night.
what's for 14?
But it was right next to their booth. It looked like it was part of it.
What's the next DLC called for 14?
Don't know yet.
We don't know. What came out over the summer was Shadowbringers.
Shadowbringers.
Oh, that's probably what
was
there.
Is that what it is? Shadowbringers?
Yes.
Shadowbringers was there.
Okay, Shadowverse is like a... I think that's like a mobile game that's been over-advertised to me like by targeted...
Kind of like that.
Mark Zuckerberg. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, literally, you see that on Twitter every time.
This looks like just a cash cow
mobile
game. Yes. Yeah.
Yeah, you probably saw Shadowbringers.
Yeah, yes, that's what it was. That's what it was.
That's the most recent 14 expansion.
Okay,
yeah.
So that's not mobile?
No,
that's
not.
Oh,
no.
That's just a big
no
huge...
No offense, I totally thought...
It's like White Wastelanders for Fallout. That's like, it's a big, huge...
It's an MMO.
It's free, right?
It's like World of Warcraft.
Or is it paid for?
14, there's a free trial, but it's a paid
game. What?
15 a month.
No, not 14. I'm saying when the DLCs come to 14, do they come free?
$30.
No, yeah, they're like 30. Like 30.
Pay $30 really? Bucks when a new one comes out.
Oh my god, but
that's much
Destiny,
content.
That's
so
like
much stuff.
What Destiny
it's totally exactly. Like, and you know what? I'll tell you one thing. That was one of my games of the year last year.
Was it really?
Shadowbringers.
Interesting.
It was. I remember that. Yeah. I've heard people cry during that story.
That story is beautiful.
Yeah. It's so funny because we've had this discussion, but it's so janky and clanky story-wise in the beginning, and I can't wait for a better story.
They tighten that shit up
story.
Real quick.
If a member...
Real long, actually.
A member who plays for the subscription of Fallout... tell you what's on my
You're
mind.
You're always on Fallout.
Final Fantasy 14, if a member waits, let's say the new thing comes out and they don't get it, they don't have access to it. Obviously, it's a part of the world that's locked off or whatever.
Yeah.
If they wait, after a few months, does it eventually become free for the membership when a new one comes out?
No.
But you do get bundles. They are cheaper to buy together.
Okay.
Base game's its own. You got to pay for it, too.
Yeah, okay.
I was just wondering, because the way...
But you can play the game for free until level 30, I think. Then you got to buy everything after.
So, until level 15,
I was just wondering, ESO, the way ESO works is it'll come out, and then when a new one comes out, they change classification, and it becomes free to members. But cool. It takes a while. It takes like 6 months to a year before that happens. I was just wondering.
Cool.